The Theory of Political Economy by William Stanley Jevons. Chapter 5. Theory of Labor. Part 5. Balance between Need and Labor. In considering this theory of labor, an interesting question presents itself. Supposing that circumstances alter the relation of produce to labor, what effect will this have upon the amount of labor which will be exerted? There are two effects to be considered. When labor produces more commodity, there is more reward, and therefore more inducement to labor. If a workman can earn 9 pence an hour instead of 6 pence, may he not be induced to extend his hours of labor by this increased result? This would doubtless be the case were it not that the very fact of getting half as much more than he did before lowers the utility to him of any further addition. By the produce of the same number of hours, he can satisfy his desires more completely. And if the irksomeness of labor has reached at all a high point, he may gain more pleasure by relaxing that labor than by consuming more products. The question thus depends upon the direction in which the balance between the utility of further commodity and the painfulness of prolonged labor turns. In our ignorance of the exact form of the functions, either of utility or of labor, it will be impossible to decide this question in an a priori manner. But there are a few facts which indicate in which direction the balance does usually turn. Statements are given by Porter in his Progress of the Nations, which show that when a sudden rise took place in the prices of provisions in the early part of this century, workmen increased their hours of labor, or, as it is said, worked double time if they could obtain adequate employment. Now a rise in the price of food is really the same as a decrease of the produce of labor, since less of the necessaries of life can be acquired in exchange for the same money wages. We may conclude, then, that English laborers enjoy little more than the necessaries of life will work harder the less the produce, or, which comes to the same thing, will work less hard as the produce increases. Evidence to the like effect is found in the general tendency to reduce the hours of labor at the present day, owing to the improved real wages now enjoyed by those employed in mills and factories. Artisans, mill hands, and others seem generally to prefer greater ease to greater wealth, thus proving that the painfulness of labor varies so rapidly as easily to overbalance the gain of utility. The same rule seems to hold throughout the mercantile employments. The richer a man becomes, the less does he devote himself to business. A successful merchant is generally willing to give a considerable share of his profits to a partner or to a staff of managers and clerks rather than bear the constant labor of superintendence himself. There is also a general tendency to reduce the hours of labor in mercantile offices due to increased comfort and opulence. It is obvious, however, that there are many intricacies in a matter of this sort. It is not always possible to graduate work to the worker's liking. In some businesses, a man who insisted on working only a few hours a day would soon have no work to do. In the professions of law, medicine, and the like, it is the reputation of enjoying a large practice which attracts new clients. Thus, a successful barrister or physician generally labors more severely as his success increases. This result partly depends upon the fact that the work is not easily capable of being performed by deputy. A successful barrister, too, soon begins to look forward to the intrinsic rewards of a high judicial or parliamentary position. But the case of an eminent solicitor, architect, or engineer is one where the work is to a great extent done by employees, and done without reference to social or political rewards, and where yet the most successful man endures the most labor, or rather is most constantly at work. This indicates that the irksomeness of the labor does not increase so as to overbalance the utility of the increment of reward. In some characters, and in some occupations, in short, success of labor only excites to new exertions. The work itself being an interesting and stimulating nature, but the general rule is to the contrary effect, namely that a certain success disinclines a man to increased labor. It may be added that in the highest kinds of labor, such as those a philosopher, scientific discoverer, artist, etc., it is questionable how far great success is compatible with ease, The mental powers must be kept in perfect training by constant exertion, just as a racehorse or an oarsman needs to be constantly exercised. Is it evident that questions of this kind depend greatly upon the character of the race? Persons of an energetic disposition feel labor less painfully than their fellow men, and if they happen to be endowed with various and acute sensibilities, their desire of further acquisition never ceases. A man of lower race, a Negro for instance, enjoys possession less, and loathes labor more. His exertions, therefore, soon stop. A poor savage would be content to gather the almost gratuitous fruits of nature, if they were sufficient to give him sustenance. It is only physical want which drives him to exertion. The rich man in modern society is supplied, apparently, with all he can desire, and yet he often labors unceasingly for more. Bishop Berkeley, in his Querist, has very well asked whether the creating of wants be not the likeliest way to produce industry in a people, and whether if our Irish peasants were accustomed to eat beef and wear shoes, they would not be more industrious.